إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، أعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، خير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، فإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة، كل ضلالة في النار، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's the only one worthy of praise. I seek His help, His guidance, and His forgiveness. I believe in Him and I trust Him. I seek refuge on Almighty Allah from the evil of our passions. Indeed, whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides him to Islam, no one can mislead him after Allah. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him astray, no one can guide him after Allah. I testify openly that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah Rabbil Alameen. And I testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger and the seal of all the prophets. O Muslims, you must know that the best speech is the speech of Almighty Allah, which is the Quran. The best guidance is the course of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is his sunnah. The worst of all affairs is innovation and addition to the religion of Islam. Indeed, every addition to the religion of Islam will lead to hellfire. I adjure you as well as myself to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the best of your ability. Fear Allah, have the taqwa of Allah, and don't die unless you are in a state of Islam. After this, I greet you all with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and the blessing of Almighty Allah be with you all. I'd like to welcome you all for continuation of our series Tarbiyah. We have stopped for more than almost a month or more due to the fasting and the Eid. And inshallah, we will start from today to continue our Tuesday class and try to finish this book, which talks about a unique subject. It's a very important subject for every Muslim. Those who are revert to Islam, convert to Islam, or those who are born Muslims. Tarbiyah, cultivation. If a Muslim focus only about seeking knowledge, but are not putting the knowledge in action, this is a serious problem. And be worse, because the person who doesn't know, he may be exempt in some cases, but the person who knows and is not acting according, this is would be a serious problem for them. The tarbiyah is related to how to live the knowledge, how to cultivate, how to raise up the new generation, how to be the proper Muslims in our behavior, in our discipline. And cultivation, it takes a lot. Nowadays, with this modern technology, we see that microchips or laptop or iPad or any of the things can have more memories than us and faster to give answer. And you have this, I think a lady called Siri or whatever her name that you tells you, she will give you the answer before you finish your question. You don't have a human being that do this, okay? But this technology became so speedy and so fast and so quick to give you the answer before you finish your question. So what I'm trying to say is that a human being is not a piece of metal or a plastic or a platinum or any of the things. A human being is a flesh and a heart. It's not only a blood, there is a soul, there is a heart. The development of the heart is something very important in Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet told us in the hadith, that إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ صِوَرِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَىٰ أَجْسَادِكُمْ. Allah doesn't care to your looks or your shapes, but Allah cares about your hearts and your deed. So a lot of Muslims, they focus in the knowledge, the memorization and competition. You have a lot of competition in knowledge and recitation of the Quran. But the reality that the competition should be in our action, in our behavior, in our discipline. And this is something that relates to every male and female, adult or a child, something very important. It takes a lot of attention of the parents, the teachers, the leaders, the people who lead any Islamic effort to observe their members, their followers, and to try to direct them and discipline, and to try to shape them up. Because if the people did not take care of the tarbiyah, the nourishment, the upbringing to bring about a better generation, this will be the ending of Islam, in a sense that Islam will be in books but not in action. It been said to some scholars that somebody memorized the whole Bukhari. So his statement or comments about it, that we have additional copy in the library. That means if we became only a people who memorize but not put in action, so that means like you have another copy of the hadith book sitting in the shelf. And you know, books sitting on the shelf could not help. But when these books turn to action and behavior, this is the change will happen. People nowadays need to hear these words, because all this revolution that we hear about it in different Islamic countries, changing the head of the Islamic State or the Kafir State or whatever state they have, it doesn't change the condition of the people. People remain to be in the same bad habits and the same poverty, the same problems. Because some people think changing one head or is going to change the whole society. This is not the way how the Prophet ﷺ started. The Prophet ﷺ even had worshipped Allah and taught Islam while idols, 360 of them, been sitting on the Kaaba. So he ﷺ had put his main focus on changing the hearts and the behavior of the people, training them, disciplining them, educating them, sitting with them, traveling with them, talking to them. This is a change that's happening this way. As a result of this, we see that Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, when she been questioned about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mannerism, behavior, she said, "Kana khuluquhu al-Quran." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his behavior, his discipline was the Quran. That means if you want to really see the Prophet in front of you, read the Quran. What the Quran say do, This what was the prophet was doing. Whatever the Quran say, don't do it. This was the prophet to stay away from it. So the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, you may can say, was a live copy of the Quran. The Quran as a book is in lines, in letters, in pages. But the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a walking Quran. That means he sees the Quran in the daily life and the behavior of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Failure of this had made the Muslim Ummah became the weakest of all Ummahs. Okay? Muslims, they was not always as we see nowadays. Okay? You hear about Palestine, about Iraq and Syria and Egypt and Somalia. You hear about all these things in the news. Okay? And the people been even taken out of their countries. They've been displaced in different non-Muslim countries. Their churches even taken them, supposed to be giving them refuge, okay, give them shelters. But in actuality, this is another way to take the Muslims from their Islam, turning them to be Christian or something else, okay? So degradation and of the Muslim Ummah came as a result of abandoning their deen in action. Because nowadays we have a lot of people who memorize the Quran as example. And the sad story is that one time I was looking in YouTube and I saw competition of the Quran among who the best memorizer of the Quran and who's the best in sound and voice. And among them was a Morocco lady that was reciting the Quran, singing the Quran. And in the back on the stage behind the lady was supposed to be sheikhs and scholars. And this is totally something different from the teaching of the Quran, because the teaching of the Quran is saying, فَلَا تَخْضَعْنَا بِالْقَوْلِ فَيَطْمَعَ الَّذِي فِي قَلْبِهِ مَرَضٌ. Do not soften your voice. A woman, when she talks with a man that is not a mahram or a husband of her, or is not first degree relative to her, is not supposed to soften her talk, because this is a will exciting, okay, became a need of exciting the person hearing her voice. So now, this is the order and this is the proper behavior for a Muslim woman. Now, instead of the people living the Quran and a woman only talk when is necessary and talk like you understand if there is a necessity with the opposite sex, okay, and they talk in a normal tone. But now we have a woman sitting on a stage, okay? Raising her arms, you understand, and putting in her ears, and they try to sing the Quran, and how to elongate it, and how to make it like a singing, okay? How to excite the people. So there is a saying, say, رُبَّ قَارِئِ لِلْقُرْآنِ وَالْقُرْآنِ يَلْعَنُ. Perhaps there is a reciter of the Quran, and the Quran is cursing him back. Because you're doing the opposite, okay? But what is said more that so-called shuyukh or a scholar sitting on the stage, so these are the referee. That means everyone, you understand, given her out of five a number, that she was good or she was excellent, she very good, based on what? In memorization and good voice. How a woman can entertain men with her voice? This is not Islamically right. So you can see that the people are being elevated in accumulating knowledge, but the degradation and going down on putting the knowledge in action. Okay? So living the Quran, teaching the Quran, to have the discipline of the Quran, this is something that became missing for centuries among the Muslim Ummah. And this is what had caused them to be weak and to be the lower, if it's not the lowest nation that on the earth today. Okay? basically most of the Islamic countries, you don't find one of them that fabricate or invent machines or cars or anything like this. Basically, all what they do, they buy from others. So they are not good in dunya, neither they are good in deen. So they lost their status, okay? So basically, they are became a good market for the non-Muslim countries. Some non-Muslim countries, they do the things. They do machines, they do transportation, they do cars, airplane, and the Muslim country buying, nothing but buying, okay? So they are not good in their dunya, neither they are good in their deen. As a result of this, they lost their lands. You found wars in Iraq, in Libya, in Syria, in Egypt, in Somalia, you can name it. Revolution everywhere. Why? Because there is no practice of Islam. And the sad story is that you found these people, when time for Salah comes, they get up and make Salah. So basically, they did not get the idea. They don't have the full picture of Islam. Islam is not about Salah, but Salah is part of Islam. You see, Islam is not Salah. Salah is part of Islam, but Islam is the whole thing. The whole thing in everything, how to live Islam. So inshallah, our class today is supposed to be among these theories. We had covered 33 classes already, and this will be the third, fourth class in this. And we're talking today about behavior, how to raise a better ummah, a better members of the Muslim community in their behavior, in their discipline, in their interaction with one another, all right? And the interaction is something that is important, is necessary. Yes, you can stay by yourself, all right? But this is not what you've been created for, because there are certain things need help of each other, assistance of one another. There is a thing you say that one hand doesn't clap, you see? So to produce this sound and this voice or whatever you call it, you need two hands, okay? So you can live as individual, but this is not what going to produce or change. We are about to change, we're about production, about improvement. So you need more than one person. So in the absence of the left hand, the right hand could not do too much. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying in the hadith, which is the meaning is, Al-mu'min الذي يخالط الناس ويصبر على أذاهم أحب إلى الله تبارك وتعالى من المؤمن الذي لا يخالط الناس ولا يصبر على أذاهم أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. A believer who mixes with the other believers and he is patient with their annoyment is much better than the believer who is not mixing and he's not patient with their annoyment. So now you can choose which one you want. You can be a believer and you can sit there in a farm by yourself, you and your goats and your sheep, you understand, and eat from the eggs that the chicken lay out every day, and you can be comfortable away from everybody and enjoy life, okay? And when a deer is crossing, you're shooting, and now you have meat for the whole month in the freezer, and that's it. Or you can go to be part of the Muslim ummah. But when you be part of the Muslim Ummah, it's going to be interaction. And this interaction bring about sometimes disunity or disagreement or disappointments. It happened. But the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he prefer the believers who interact with the people and what? Be patient. Be patient. Because if you and your goat, you're not going to be fighting the goats and the sheep. Okay? And mostly you can do what? You can take a stick and hit them in the back. They will get in, and that's it. But with the Muslims, they understand somebody doesn't like the way how you look, somebody doesn't like the way how you dress, somebody doesn't like the way you talk, somebody doesn't like the speed of your activity in the community, and he think he can be better than you in doing, and they try to challenge you to be the other, okay, boss.
like I say, everybody want to be what you call no, what is this? Everybody want to be, nobody want to be an Indian. There is a saying,
too many chiefs and not enough Indians.
Many hands in the pot burning. No, I'm talking about everybody want to be a chief, the chief, and does no one want to be the Indian, okay? So this of coming together as one body and they try to work is going to be some kind of ill feeling sometimes, some uncomfort. They are not going to be comfortable. But this is better to be mixing, and not only mixing, to be mixing and be patient with their disturbance. It's going to happen, okay? So mannerism is part of the Muslim's life. And interaction is something necessary in his life, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering us and say, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Help one another towards righteousness and good deed. Anything need to be established, okay? It need more than one person. Even for something small like a family, okay? The wife would do something and the husband would do something, okay? Later on, the husband and the wife, both of them doing something because the child have to grow. Later on, the child grow up and they try to contribute something to the family, you see? So it has to be some kind of a unity and coming closer to each other to do things. But if we don't have the proper behavior, the proper adab, discipline, this bringing us together is going to be like a war, okay? Would be like a zoo. The one who stronger will attack the one who is youngest, okay? Or the weakest one. So developing of our akhlaq, our behavior, and our discipline is something that Islam, the Quran, and Sunnah had focused on it a lot. Focus on it a lot. To such a degree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he spoke highly about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Indeed, you Muhammad on the highest rank of behavior and discipline. Akhlaq, behavior and discipline is something very important. You can have a master degree and PhD degree and you have very bad attitude. Nobody care about you. You can be a person who don't know even how to read or write or even sign your name, but you have behavior and discipline. Everybody would like, understand, to work with you. You see? So the akhlaq, the behavior, the discipline, your attitude with the people is something very important, very important. And Islam had focus on it. Let's say, take as example some of the examples that Hadith Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she said, مَا ضَرَبَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَسَلَّمَ بِيَدِهِ خَادِمًا قَطْ وَلَا امْرَأَ وَلَا ضَرَبَ بِيَدِهِ شَيْئًا إِلَّا أَنْ يُجَاهِدَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلَا خُيِّرَ بَيْنَ شَيْئَيْنِ إِلَّا كَانَ أَحَبَّهُمَا إِلَيْهِ أَيْسَرُهُمَا. Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, saying the Prophet ﷺ never hit anything with his hand. Not a slave, not a servant, not a woman. Okay? The Prophet ﷺ never hit somebody with his hand. Okay? Unless that he is in the battlefield. This is the difference. Because if you are not going to use your hand in the battlefield, that means you're a coward. Your enemy is going to kill you and you stand and say, okay, I'm going to be nice. This is not the time to be nice. This is the time to defend yourself. And this is the time, you understand, you have to teach the other person, you understand, a lesson. But in a normal life, keep your hand to yourself as much as you can. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us what? Al-Muslimu man salim al-Muslimuna min lisani wa yadi. A true Muslim, is the other Muslim that save from his hand and his tongue. You understand? So when you are in a peaceful situation, it's not a war, okay? In discussion, in a meeting, in a house talk, whatever it is. There is no need for guns, there is no need for knives, there is no need for glasses, There is no need, you understand, to even use your face, okay? People can talk, people can have discussion, okay? So the Prophet ﷺ never, and he says that the good Muslim is the one that the rest of the community are safe from his tongue and his hand. Some people, you understand, they say, I never bother anybody. I keep my hand to myself. But guess what? Their tongue doing more damage than their hands. Their tongue doing more damage than their hands. Backbiting, slandering, especially with the modern technology. Something happening in the mosque, look how small is the mosque. It can be in a second or 10 seconds be in China. Okay? Why? Because we have now the Facebook, the internet, and we have all the stuff, and we spread it everywhere. So that means the early Muslims, when if somebody make a backbite, he will be what? Among 10, 20, 100 people, and this is it. But imagine today that in a minute, he slander the Imam or the community, it will be all over the United States in less than 2 minutes. And everybody understand, and now somebody in America will take it and send it to somebody. His friend used to be in America, but he's in China. And the person in China understand, he will take it and what you call, resend it to somebody in Japan. Okay? So now you can see how Muslims can damage communities, how Muslims can damage people's marriage while they're still sitting in their office on in their house. Why? Because they don't have the proper adab. Okay? They did not have the proper behavior. This is not my business. And the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من حسن إسلام المرء تركه ما لا يعنيه. One of the best characteristic, the best characteristic of a Muslim, leaving alone what it doesn't concern you. Okay? Oh, guess what? This brother, you understand, he left his wife. Guess what? This sister, you understand, left her husband. Guess what? So what is your business? People left or stay? Okay? He got fired, man. I told you, he's crook, man. Why? Why all these things? After this, understand, after 5 minutes, everybody making wudu, Allahu Akbar, making salah, and nothing happened. All right? So we have to understand that our behavior is something very important. So here is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, although if you are the boss or the manager or the master, you have the right to understand to discipline those who are under your supervision. Okay? Especially if you have a slave. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he has a slave, he have a servant, he have a wife, he have a children. Okay? So he doesn't use his hand unless what? In a battlefield. This shows you how much patient is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He tried to tell me that the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not one wife. Some of us, we have one wife only, okay? Not half a wife, because you could not get a half. It have to be at least one, is it? You have one wife and say, brother, my head, man, what's wrong? You have a headache? No, man, I'm talking about my wife. All your wife can be talking about the husband. I could not take. What's going on? Hey, man, this is too much for me. I don't know that marriage is like this, okay? But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he died, he had 9 wives. This shows you how patient was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Can you imagine? Can you imagine if 3 of them at mad at him in the same time? So he go here, somebody making a face, somebody making a face. And with all this, the Prophet didn't touch any of them with his hand. So Aisha is saying, and look, when the reporter come from the house, more reliable than any other place, because Aisha herself is taken about something that the normal Sahaba doesn't see it. Okay? Normal Sahaba see in the mosque, see in the street. But in the house, who would see? Because these people, they don't sit, you understand, backbiting, or he did this, you understand? And sister go to visit other sister, and instead reading Riyad al-Salihin, talking about, you understand, how to take care of the new baby, or you understand what is the best recipe that I can make, you understand, maqluba, you understand, or the bechamel, or whatever it is, talking about this and that, okay? So it's so bad. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not use his hand as a mean of discipline. And this tells you what? That he was so patient. We when we lose the patience, this is a problem. We need to develop, to learn to have more endurance with our children, with our wives, with our people who work with us, you understand? And innama sabru bitasabbur, okay? That you have, yeah, brother, I lose my, yes, but you have to learn how to swallow it and how to keep your tongue in your mouth for a couple of minutes. Okay, I'm going to take a deep breath and I'm not going to say anything. Next time, okay, 2 minutes. Okay, you see, now there is a change. Okay, now the next thing you understand, somebody even yelling and say, okay, she will calm down now, he will calm down now, okay? But if everything you jump and do it because you lost, oh, I'm sorry, I lost my patience. It doesn't work like this. Yeah, everybody understands, have a temper, but we need to work on it. So this, when it says that he did not hit anyone unless in the battlefield, it shows you how much the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have patience. And the Prophet was example for us. And we have to learn how to develop this, because this part of the way of to deal with each other. If everybody loses their control, we're not going to be able to be under the same roof. You understand? Especially in the beginning of marriage. Yes, I love you, you love me, but two different upbringing, two different mentality, two different habits, and both of them going to be under the same roof. And both of them, you understand, have to be patient to grow and to make it under the roof. Otherwise, you understand, there is no perfect husband, neither there is a perfect wife. So what's going to be? We have to both abuse it, and we're going to be patient, we have to make it. First year, second year, things will slow down, get better, get better, get better. But the first year, oh man, this is too much for me, I could not take it, forget it. I'm leaving, okay? Later for you, this is the key, okay, bye. Okay? No. So when it says that the Prophet ﷺ, because the slaves, the wife, the children, all these things can upset, but the Prophet did not use his hand. That means he was so patient, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Never the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam been given a choice between two matters unless the Prophet will choose what? The easier one. So what? Which one? Okay. Which one that you want? Okay? Especially when it comes about husband and wife. Okay? Sometimes because the husband wants his way or the wife wants to make sure that he listens to her sometimes, okay? So, okay, at dinner, you love red lobster, or you want to go to Chick-fil-A or whatever? It doesn't matter which one. It's going to be a Pizza Hut or pizza, the other one, I don't know what the other hot pizza, okay? Pizza's pizza, okay, no, but this you understand, and but 10 reasons. But actually, it's not because only to show that I am the boss. Now, the Prophet was not like this. When he'd been given a choice between two things, he will do what? Take the easy one. Okay, honey, it's okay. Which one you like? Pizza Hut? Okay, we'll go to Pizza Hut. Okay? So the next one will be pizza from Sam's. All right? Because, all right? So this one thing also we need to learn. In our midst and our working together, two things. As long both of them, okay, you have the bus and you got the subway or the train. Same time, okay? This okay, this is not my problem, okay? Inshallah, as long we don't lose our connection here, this is fine, okay? So which one? Okay, maybe I think I understand the train will be more reliable, or I think the bus you understand more faster. At least try to explain why you choosing this, okay, to make things more acceptable to your partner or the people who working with you. As long as the other choice, because the easier one can be something haram in it, No, I don't want, because these people, they cook lard. They both understand khinzir on the beats. Now this is something different now. Why? It's not because I don't want to go to Pizza Hut, but because there is Islamic problem there or Islamic reason that I don't want. But the way of the Prophet ﷺ never ever given a choice between two matters, and the Prophet will choose which one. Either say, brother, man, you need to show your wife you are as a man, man. Everything he tells you, understand, you go, you understand. Come on, no, tell her, doesn't matter. Both of them happy. So why you are sticking your nose there and they tell, no, you have to show that you understand. Okay. Okay, you want us to go and see my brother or see my sister tonight? We're going to visit, as example. So, okay. Stay away from people business. Try to learn and understand that. Make a choice that easier as long as not haram. Okay? If it's something that haram there, so now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will stay away. Okay? He's not going to choose it because the easier one, because there is something wrong about it. وَمَنْ تَقَمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِلَّا أَنْ تُنْتَهَكْ حُرْمَةُ اللَّهِ فَيَنْتَقِمُ لِلَّهِ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never take revenge. Okay? Unless somebody transgress the limits of Allah. Okay? Sometimes, yes, we are human being. But we need, when we make a mistake, we try to think. You know, sometimes we say, okay, I'm going to teach him a lesson. He think he's tough, I'm going to show him I'm tough, okay? He comes with two guys, I'm going to bring four guys and I'll go by his house. You see? It's sometimes the shaitan comes to play in your emotion and they try to buff you up and make you feel that I'm going to teach him a lesson, I'm going to show him I am the man, okay? If you sit down a little bit, if you think about it for a little bit, if you go make wudu and sit down and relax, okay, say A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim, you see something totally different, you see? So we don't want to get trapped by the shaitan. But when that a person really will be, I'm going to have to do something about it, when something that been transgressed the limits of Allah, now the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will take what? Would take a revenge. Can you imagine somebody come and asking the Prophet ﷺ for a charity? For a charity, okay? But he come and choking the Prophet ﷺ, grabbing him by his kameez, say, give me from this charity you got. This not your property or the property of your parents. Give. You come begging, at least have this and be nice. But some of those people are Bedouin. They don't know the basic mannerism. Like, you understand, this man came in the mosque and he urinated there. So some of the people who live in the rural area or away from civilization and away, they don't know how to behave in the best manner. But the Prophet ﷺ did not act with them in the same manner. The Sahaba is about to go and beat up these people, but the Prophet said, leave them alone, let me deal with them, okay? So only the Prophet ﷺ will take a revenge when somebody stepping the boundary that have been set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's go a little bit details about this issue we're talking about. What is this husn al-khuluq? So what it is that to be patient and this earth, you understand, or don't get angry fast. And husn al-khuluq is a whole system dealing with your behavior. Behavior is something, your personality, you understand, who you are, how you going to really be, to react and interact, how you going to react and interact, okay, about things and with the people. So some of the saying of the early Muslims talking about husn al-khuluq, what is husn al-khuluq? إمام الحسن سي حسن الخلق بسط الوجه. He have a chair face. Okay? That you don't always have a, what you call a mad face. Okay? Try to have like halfway smile at least in your face. Understand? Okay? Somebody come and he still you understand have your face as if somebody bust you in your head and give you or you didn't have your coffee in the morning, how you acting now this one. No, act as if you already got a Starbucks. Although I don't advise you to buy Starbucks because it's very expensive, okay? And we shouldn't be wasting our money in things and you can get McDonald's coffee it's for $1.50, is this enough? Go and spend $5. But anyway, I'm not advertising for any store now here, but please understand when you spend it, try to see how you're spending your money. Coffee is coffee. And you guess what? Do you know what is the best coffee? Anybody know? No, no coffee. This is the best coffee. Because it's not good for your system, okay? You get used to it and after this you get headache if you don't drink it. And why you don't take this money instead of buying coffee and put it in charity jar and save it and help some Muslim, you get blessings, you get blessing Jannah. Okay, it's no need for you, actually. It's a matter of a habit. Coffee and tea and all these things is a more something, a habit, than a necessity or a need. All right? So the best coffee is no coffee brand. Okay? No coffee, no coffee. All right? So, it's a bustle watch. So some people that, because they get used to coffee, if you meet them in the morning and oh, I'm sorry, I just woke up and I didn't get my coffee yet. I could not even open my eyes, you understand? So they be acting like, so don't meet the people in this kind of face. How you, what you call this face? Angry face or mad face or?
Mean,
huh? A mini face, yes. Can I say mini? Mini mind, you know? Yeah, mean face. You know about it, Muhammad, huh? You must be practicing it, huh? Yeah. But you good, your wife is so patient. Don't make men. Okay, so this is part of حسن الخلق وبذل الندى وكف الأذى, that give from what you got, all right, and keep your harm to yourself. That means keep your hand to yourself. Do not disturb others. If you come with these three qualities, okay, that a person, you don't meet the people with a mean face, and you are a person who try to assist even with the leftover, the little bit, and that you keep your hand to yourself, now you have حسن الخلق, a good characteristic and good behavior. Abu Uthman is saying, هو الرضا عن الله تعالى. And this is a big, 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 big word. He said, proper behavior, that you be content and pleased with Allah. You be pleased with Allah. This is a very heavy term. We want Allah to be pleased with us. But for me to be pleased with Allah, I'm not saying it backwards. Yeah, there is a term say to be pleased with Allah. What does this mean to be pleased with Allah? First of all, if we are pleased with Allah or displeased with Allah, what's going to happen to Allah? Nothing. But if Allah displeased with us, it's a big trouble, is it? Huh? It's a big trouble. So what does it mean by to be pleased with Allah? هو الرضا عن الله تبارك وتعالى. To train yourself, discipline yourself to be content and sufficed by Allah. He said, to be pleased and content towards Allah. Sahl al-Tasatturi say, the minimum of proper akhlaq, proper behavior, to be patient with what is false in you. Calamities, bad news, whatever it is that can happen to you. Try not to be eye to eye or ear to ear by the people. He slap me, I'm going to slap him. He curse me, I'm going to curse him. Okay? Leave it. والرحمة للظالم that you feel bad, okay, for the wrong one, and that you seek forgiveness for him, and you feel bad for him. That a person who transgressing against you, taking your property, that you feel sorry for him, all right? Because he's the wrong side, all right? And that you ask forgiveness, that Allah forgive him, and you really your heart go for him. This is a very, very special manner. Can you imagine somebody who wronged you or taken your property, stepping your toe, and after this that you feel sorry for him? And you say, may Allah forgive him. And that you even make a dua for him. It's not easy, huh? But this is a high, people go, you understand, try for master degree, PhD degree. People try to get higher degree. But how many people they try really sincere and serious to grow in their akhlaq, in their behavior? Okay? Somebody accused me, I said, okay, may Allah forgive them. Somebody understand, snatch my wallet, okay? And now I'm not going to shoot him in the head, but I say, Allah forgive him. Maybe he understand, he will feel sorry about what he did, okay? Whatever it is. It's total reverse reaction or something like this. And instead of punching the person that now is, look, because something wrong with him, he did something like this. He doesn't really think about Allah, so he took this thing unlawfully. So you will feel sorry for the wrongdoer, and you seek forgiveness for him, and you feel hurt for him. It's saying, أَلَّا يَتَّهِمَ الْحَقِّ فِي الرِّزْقِ, that you don't accuse Allah in the provision. Listen to this. How does it mean to be pleased with Allah? They say husnul khuluq is to be pleased with Allah. How can I be pleased with Allah, not Allah pleased with me? He said, do not accuse Allah in his division. Oh, why understands this person? Allah gave him all this money and I have nothing. Look, this man, you understand, only for 5 minutes consultation, he made $500. I don't even have $5 a day. I go look for a work all day, I don't have $5. Allah is testing you, okay? Allah is the provider. Does Allah own you this $5 or the $500? Allah doesn't own us anything. So say, do not accuse, okay? Do not even think bad about Allah that he gives so and he didn't give you. That be content with Allah. You know what's happening to you is by the qadr and the decree and the predestination of Allah. So you do your best. I went everywhere. I got application. I tried to work. I tried searching. But nothing came today. So what? Say Alhamdulillah. And you still go to the mosque and you're going to make salah and say Alhamdulillah. And somebody say, crazy man, Alhamdulillah for what? You didn't even make $5 today. And you're telling me you're going to be a Muslim? So he became a Muslim. Look, the whole day he did not make $5. Look, you understand? Man, this thing, go ahead. Go in the corner there, sell it. You'll be making, you understand, $50. 50 bucks in a, like this. Okay, let your Islam help you. To be pleased with Allah, never look down on Allah in his provision. And knowing that what he's doing is what is right, is not what you think is right. He may give to somebody and doesn't give you. You don't know if he give you what you're going to have it to you. You don't know if it's the right. Okay? So never accuse Allah concerning what he gives you or what he withhold you. Have a full trust in him. And have a full confidence in what Allah promised, like Jannah, that Allah give you stability in the earth if you be the true believers, that Allah will change the condition. Whatever Allah had promised, that you have a trust in His promise. As a result of this, you will obey Allah, never disobey Him, at all cases. Regardless with the order that He command you to do, or He order you to pay it to others. That the ibadah of Allah is not only what you do between you and Allah, like fasting and salah, but there is other things like respecting the people, you understand, obeying your parents, be patient with the, understand, the youngest, and all these things. So there is a relationship between you and Allah, and there is a relationship between you and people. So you obey Allah in both relations. Not only focus in my salah and my fasting, and after this, your relationship with the people is too bad. This is not. So being content with Allah and pleased with Allah, that you try to fulfill your duties towards Allah and your duties towards the people. وقيل حسن الخلق بذل الجميل وكف القبيح. حسن الخلق, good behavior, giving the best of yourself and keeping the bad and the worse away from the people. وقيل تخلي عن الرذائل والتحلي بالفضائل, that you try to beautify yourself with all good things and to stay, okay, away from all the bad things. Imam Yahya ibn Mu'adh is saying, في سعة الأخلاق كنوز الأرزاق. Okay? Having a good behavior is the treasure of all wealth. Have good akhlaq, good behavior, good discipline. This is like a treasures. Okay? Not only money. Okay? You can have a lot of money and people still hating you. They don't like to see you. Okay? One of the righteous people is saying, سوء الخلق, bad behavior, bad characteristic, too much good deed doesn't help. That both of them is not. Okay, you have bad behavior and you don't a lot of good deeds, it's going to spoil it. And good behavior and a lot of sins, this will remove the sins. That means do not focus only about doing good deeds, but your akhlaq is bad. Okay? Try to balance yourself. Try to understand that akhlaq is part of the deen. Do not only think about reading Quran and making salah. You have to know how to behave, how to be with the people. This is something very important. Al-Junaid is saying, four things which raise the people and elevate the people in ranks, even if they have little bit knowledge and little bit deed. Hilm, tawadu, sakha, husn al-khuluq. Alright? Four things. Four things will elevate you, even if your knowledge is little and your deed is little. All right? What it is? He said, to be easygoing, to be humble, to be charitable or generous, and husn al-khuluq, this is the perfection of your iman. Another imam by name Yusuf ibn Asbat saying, there is 10 things to summarize good akhlaq. 10 things. If you have them, now you have a good behavior. Qillat al-khilaf, husn al-insaf, wa tarku talb al-atharat, wa tahsin ma yabdu min al-sayyi'at, والتماس المعذرة واحتمال الأذى والرجوع بالملامة على النفس والتفرد بمعرفة عيوب نفسه دون غيره وطلاقة الوجه للصغير والكبير ولطف الكلام لمن دونه ولمن فوقه. 10 things we should learn this. It should be a list that we put it in our you know, in the kitchen you have the refrigerator and you have this magnet and they put recipes and things like this. We need to have this recipe and look to it every day and try. Maybe in a week time, month time, a year time, we accomplish one of them. That means you understand after 10 months or 10 years that we have the whole list, but it's better than nothing. You see? Slowly but surely. All right? So say حسن الخلق, good behavior, are memorized in 10 items. Number one, قلة الخلاف. The minimum of disagreement and dispute. Okay? Disputes, disagreements, minimize it as much as you can. Number two, be fair. Okay? Be fair. Yes, I am the owner, but yes, I mistake. Okay, I try to give you a refund. Or I'm the manager. Yes, I was hastening this decision. I'll give you your day back, you understand, of whatever it is. Okay? Have insaf, being fair. Alright? Doesn't matter who you are, whatever position. You make a mistake, say I made a mistake. That's it. Alright? But don't keep arguing and try to prove that you're right. Don't hunt the mistakes of the people. This is number three. Do not be fishing for people's mistakes, faults. Like you say, when you point finger to people, what? Four fingers pointing towards you. Okay, you did this, you did this, okay? But look, there's the other fingers is saying, he did this, he did, okay? Try to stop hunting and fishing. There are some people actually, they're fishing for people's mistakes. And this is not nice. This is not from the akhlaq. Okay? Everybody have faults. Okay? And there is a saying they say, there is no scholar, لكل عالم سهوة ولكل جواد كبوة. Every scholar, he may forget, and every good horse, he may fall one time. Doesn't matter how good the horse, how scholar he is, the person. Okay? Perfection, perfection only belongs to Allah. So stop fishing for people's mistakes. Try to cover up the bad deed of the, what you see from the people. Okay? You say, oh brother, maybe you understand he's late because something happened to his car. Or maybe understand he forgot to come to the meeting, you understand, because just try to find excuse for people, okay, for why they, okay, did not do it. So anything you see is a bad from the people, try to find excuse why, what such a thing happened. Accepting the people excuses. Say, oh, I'm sorry, I forgot. Or I'm sorry, my phone, you understand, my battery was not the charge. I missed your call. Okay? Okay. It's okay, no problem. Try to accept the people excuse. احتمال الأذى, forbearing. Okay? Annoyment, be patient with the annoyment of the people. Always try to accuse yourself and admonish yourself. Okay? Before you admonishing others. Try to be the first one to check your faults, okay? Before the people seeing your faults. That means recognize your faults and try to do something about it, okay? Number nine, have a cheering face for the big, and for the older and the younger. And be easy in your words for those who are above you or lower than you. Okay, Allahu Akbar, we're going to stop here and inshallah continue next week for talking more about akhlaq. We still have at least one or two classes related to akhlaq, and I think it's something very important that we need to cook it good, because good akhlaq, it can keep marriage together, it can keep community together, it can keep ummah together, you understand? People can make it together with their akhlaq. People love their money, people love their houses. But at the same time, if the people have some kind of patience, tolerance, forgiveness, patience with each other, okay? It's not everybody has the money to give you so you can love them. But with akhlaq, people can love us, people can work with us, and we can build a better community, a better mosque, inshallah. And we got an idea what we're talking about when we're talking about good akhlaq, inshallah. Hopefully, inshallah, that we benefit from this class, try to put it in action, and we'll be good if you make attempt to listen to the class again, once and twice. Sometimes it makes things drill, you understand? A drill goes inside and it starts to become part. When you hear it one time, two times, three times, you understand, it will goes inside and it starts to become part of your system, inshallah. Looking forward to see you again, inshallah, next week, Tuesday, 7 o'clock. This is our time for the class. Anybody have comments, correction, question, feel free to do so.
It takes a lot of discipline.
Yeah, but this, what is the only thing going to fix it, you understand? Otherwise, we're going to be always in each other's throat. This is how they say it, to be in each other's throat. Sometimes, you understand, you're going to have to swallow it. And sometimes, you understand, you're going to act as if you didn't hear it. This is the only thing, you understand? Otherwise, what are you saying? Okay. I heard you, all right. Watch what you're just about. Sometimes, you understand. And the main thing that when we do something, we do it for Allah. When you let it go, you let it go for Allah. Because if you let it go because you're scared, now this is he called being coward. But if you have the ability to say back to him or to her what's been said, or to punch him back and do it, you understand? And you let it go for Allah, now this is different. So when somebody do it because being coward, this is not what we're talking about. But we're talking about that people will do what is better. Not because they're scared or they could not do it, but they're doing it for the sake of Allah. Say, let it go for Allah's sake. This is it. Inshallah. Jazakum Allah khairan. Yes, ma'am.
And this is with all mankind?
Excuse me? To all mankind, you're talking about Muslim and non-Muslims? Wallah, I'm not giving you an answer to the question, or you call it Islamic answer, but this is not what I'm saying as Quran and Hadith to back it up, but you need to test your water, okay? Some people, with the Muslims, of course, we have to be patient with each other extra. With the non-Muslims, okay, that test your water. That means some people say, okay, thanks a lot. You say, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to say it like this. They say, okay. And some people, when you say, understand, this okay, they're going to slap you on the other cheek. All right? So it depends. We have to see the people that we deal with them. Some people, you understand, they will acknowledge your patience and your forgiveness and your tolerance, and they will be better. And some people, they will take this as a point of weakness and they try to jump on your shoulder. Okay? So, test your water. But nevertheless, akhlaq, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, idfa billati hi ahsan. Reply back with the best. فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم. And this will make the person that have animosity between you and him or her turn to be the best friend. Some people will say, okay, I'm sorry to hear that you talk in this way. I'm not expecting this from somebody like you, but this okay. Thanks a lot. I say, oh, I'm sorry. I misunderstood. I didn't mean it. Right away, they will catch it. And now say, oh, I'm sorry. And some people understand that. They will try to take advantage. So I say, okay, next time you do this, I'm going to report you to your manager, as example. Or I'm going to understand to do this about it. Take action. Because Islamically, we have the right. Somebody slap you, you can slap them back. It's your right. But Allah says those who forgive and forgo is better. But to some people who did not understand about behavior and discipline, and you use this methodology with them, they may think this is weakness in your part. So you have to see who you're dealing with to deal with. But with the Muslims, always try to put the best construction in it, and they try to be the best of the two sons of Adam. Do you know what this means? He say, try always to be the best of the two sons of Adam. He say, لَأَقْتُلَنَّكَ. Okay, he said, I will kill you. He said to him, if you extend your hand to kill me, I'm not going to kill you. Okay, because I will let you carry my sins and your sins. So always try to be the best of the two sons of Adam. Okay, that not to strike back. But if a person, you understand, is not going to be learn a lesson from your kindness and your patience, now, next time, I understand, it's going to be a different tone and a different treatment. And Allah knows best. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.